brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I won't be quiet, my God is alive, so how could I keep it inside? Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord.
Praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you.
Guys, and do things different. So, all out of order, why don't you turn to your neighbor, find somebody you don't know, and tell them how glad you are to see him this morning. And a special message from Rich: if you're a middle schooler, you're not dismissed yet. Let's get back to our seats. Let's just continue this morning in worship. I'm getting over a cold, so you guys are going to really have to help me sing this one.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see the mountain. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear, for I am safe.
As we sing.
So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. If you are for me, who can be against me?
No.
For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Cross, God, you see an empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God,
belongs to you. And oh mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against. Sing that again, oh mighty fortress.
Oh mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh mighty fortress, you go before us. Shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I your feet.
And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the land. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the land. We'll sing the song forever and amen, and the angels cry, people see. presence was where I found home. You were there and you're here right now. In every high and every low, you never left me without hope. You were good and you're good right now. I've witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never fail. I've got stories I'll live to tell. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. You left your throne and chose the cross, laid down your life to rescue us. The Savior then, my Savior now. But even death was not the end. You conquered hell so I could live. Resurrecting then, resurrecting now. Resurrecting then, resurrecting now. I've witnessed your faithfulness, and I've seen you breathe life within. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never fail. I've got stories I live to tell, so I pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it. And I'm confident see it.
Oh, he's
again
good. We
and
sing.
Again. You're good and I've witnessed it. You're strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I'll tell them what I past your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life within, so I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never fail. I've got stories I'll live to tell, so I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it.
I've got stories I'll live to tell. As we think about that statement, that means we've walked through difficulty. We've walked through struggles. Sometimes that means we've walked through incredible experiences and joy and blessings. And in all of that, we're called to just be, to remember what Paul wrote in Romans. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. As we think about those stories, they all have a purpose in our life. To bring us to see the goodness of God, to see his strength, to see his consistent and just long-lasting love for us. And as we do that, we can tell these stories about how he's loved us, how he's healed us, and how he's saved us. And so it's with joy and sometimes tears that we share those stories with others. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the stories you've put in our life, the stories that you've called for us to share with others. Not so that we are seen as the center part, but that you are seen in the center, that your Son is seen as our Savior, and that through him and through your love for us, we can be saved, we can be restored to life, and we can continue to tell these stories. In your name we pray, amen. Well, why don't you have a seat? Well, we've already done the greeting, and so well, welcome to New Hope. We're glad you're here. If you're a visitor, we'd love for you to stop by the information booth, fill out a Connect card, or you can look in the back of the chairs. We've got a little QR code. You can fill that out. But if you stop by the information booth, one, you'll get a handshake, and two, we got a little bit of a gift for you. We got a few things coming up just to mark your calendars. This next Sunday at 4 p.m., the 29th, we have our thank you for Pastor Tim. And just celebrating the work he's done here in this transition into his new role. And so come celebrate with us at 4 p.m. You just have to come, and we'll have a great celebration and have food for you as well, or dessert. I don't know. We're doing snacks? We got a snack for you. Sorry. Men, October 19th at 8 a.m., we have a men's breakfast. I assume we'll have bacon, but just come have some fellowship together and join together and hear a little bit more about some men's ministry things going on. Great thing, October 27th is our trunk or treat. And so a great time to kind of love our community and open up not just our parking lot to lots of families and kids, but our doors as well. So we make purposeful decisions to kind of bring people into this church to give them a great experience. So sometimes people have never walked into a building like this. And so we would just want to care for our community. And so you're invited to partake in that. One, to come enjoy it. Two, if you are one of those people who likes competition, put together a trunk, and you can sign up online at newhopeon395.com /get connected and give candy away and celebrate with us. Or you can volunteer here as well. And we've got a few ways you can volunteer to help kind of connect and with people. And if you don't like any of that, I'm sure you've been to Safeway, and there's a large candy selection going on right now. If you would purchase a bag or two of candy and bring it here so we have a plethora of candy to give out, that would be great. And with that, we're just inviting people to kind of think about their schedule in serving. And so we have some opportunities to serve in our kids' ministry, both in the nursery and in teaching. And so if you're interested in that, there is a sign up online, and you can talk to Shay about that as well. And we're excited about that. And with that, we're going to ask Pastor Chris and Derek to come up here, and we're introducing our candidate for discipleship pastor.
Yeah. Good morning. How you doing this morning? It's good to see you. Men's,
Sorry. Middle school, you are now released to go to
there
class.
There you go. I'm glad you forgot that, because when I forget it, you give me a hard time, but now we're even. There you go. Man, it's great to see you all this morning. What a great one. Let's just give the Lord a hand. He's so good all the time. Amen. Man, worship was off the hook this morning. That was great. Well, hey, again, just want to say welcome to you. If you're new to New Hope, like, this is pretty unusual for us. This isn't something that we do every week, right?
I don't know.
I have no idea. This is my first Sunday.
I want to introduce you all to Derek Freed. Give Derek a hand for traveling here from Minnesota this morning. Derek is our candidate for the position Pastor of Discipleship and Connection. And, you know, that's a significant, important thing for us as a church. I think one of the things that we've struggled in a little bit, and we kind of want to build that up and fortify that by bringing someone on staff that's going to kind of focus on that area of ministry. And so we just wanted to give you an opportunity to get to know Derek just a little bit this morning. And so when we're done here, between services, if you've got questions for him, if you want to meet him, feel free to do that. But yeah, so Derek, why don't you like just tell us a little bit about your story, how you came to know Christ, and how you ended up in doing this and being in ministry and all.
Yeah, I grew up in the church. Both my parents are believers. They've been believers long before I was around. So I grew up in the church, I grew up in Eden Prairie, Minnesota. I attended a great church there called Woodville Church. It was third grade was when I kind of for the first time said, hey, I want Jesus in my life. The teacher in the Sunday school class was like, who wants Jesus in your life? I was like, I'll take some of that. Had no idea what that meant. Had no idea what I had just signed up for. Mine when I heard about a relationship with Jesus. It was the first time that I'd heard that concept about not just a one-time decision, but an ongoing relationship. And that was kind of the moment where my faith kind of became my own, and I started to kind of live it out and really orient my life around who Jesus was and all of that. And so I was actively involved in kind of my youth groups kind of all through middle school and high school and all that. Had one plan for my life. I'm giving you the cliff notes, if you know it. Do you guys even know what Cliff Notes are anymore?
Sure.
The young people probably don't know what those are anymore. I'm giving you the brief version. I had one plan for my life. God kind of, through some circumstances, basically blew that whole plan up. And so in college, I ended up taking the Foundations of Ministry class at Biola University in La Mirada, California. Loved it. And then got an internship. And it was in that internship that God just kind of solidified and kind of said, this is what you are meant to do, and you're meant to be in ministry. And so been doing that ever since. Have did about 20-plus years of student ministry and have kind of in the last few years kind of moved into more of kind of adults, higher-level leadership, things of that nature. I'll always love students, if you're a student, man, your guys' lives are crazy, and your culture changes way too fast for me now. So I just got to the point where I was like, I can't do this anymore. So kind of have transitioned, and so that's kind of what's led to some of the searching for the next thing and all of that. So
yeah. So what was the thing that kind of led you to apply to New Hope? What was kind of appealing about what we're doing here?
Yeah, I mean, I think one, I would say the position is stuff that I'm passionate about: discipleship, connection. Those are things that are vital for a church. They are incredibly important for a church. It's stuff that I love to see happen and want to see happen in a church. So the position, I think, fit with what I really want to do and want to be about. And then on top of that, as I've had conversations and learned about the church and things, it seems that it's healthy. You guys are moving in the right directions and doing the right things. I mean, even last week you kind of told me you had, I think, what, nine decisions to follow Christ for the first time.
Isn't that cool? Nine people last week. Yep.
You know, stuff like that is just awesome. And so it just made me go, man, this would be a place that might be great to be a part of. So those were the things that kind of led me to go, like, yeah, man, I want to see if God's going to do something here.
Right, yeah. See where God leads. Yeah. So So the position is a discipleship and connection. So specifically dealing with small groups, dealing with kind of a programming discipleship into the life of the church. What is disciple? Is this my mic? Is my mic just being really funky? Is that better? Don't touch it. Oh, there we go. Okay, don't touch. All right, there we go. So what, like, how would you define discipleship, and why is it important in the life of the church and the person who follows Jesus?
Yeah, I mean, that's a big question.
It is.
And I could probably take the rest of the morning and talk about that. You want a morning
off?
You want a morning off?
Yeah. No, it might be all right.
So the idea of discipleship is, it follows, obviously, the word disciple. And the idea of a disciple is somebody who would follow after their, you know, rabbi, master, stuff like that. There's a old kind of Jewish saying that would talk about disciples, and it would say, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. With the idea that you're following, like, so close behind your rabbi that his dust from his feet is literally kicking up and covering you.
That's
how closely you are following him. And so that's the idea. A disciple is somebody who follows their rabbi, their master, and wants to be like them, wants to learn everything they can about that person so that they can be just like them. And so that's essentially what discipleship is. It is following as closely after Jesus as you can to become exactly like him. And now, we'll never get there, but this is a process that, whether you are 3 years old or you are 93 years old, that you are a part of. This is a process, whether you accepted Christ last Sunday as one of those nine people, or you have been a Christian for 70 years, that you are a part of this, that this never ends. It doesn't stop. You don't reach a point where you're like, well, I'm old enough. I've been doing this long enough. I'm done.
I've arrived.
I'm a disciple. I'm here. Like, that never happens. There's more to learn and more to grow, and so a disciple is basically that. And so for me, I love to see people who, like, learn and get it, and they start to, the light bulb goes off, and they orient their life more and more around who Jesus is. They start making decisions in their life about personally, about finances, about what they serve, how they serve, their time, all that kind of stuff about Jesus and towards him. And so that's kind of, when I think of discipleship, that's what I think of.
Nice. Yeah. Amen? That's good. So, So tell us a little bit about Derek. Like, what kinds of things do you like to do in your free time? Kind of help us get to know you a little bit better in that way.
Yeah. I feel like I'm pretty eclectic. Like,
yeah.
I don't really fall into one category. I'm a big sports fan. I love sports. I grew up playing almost every sport there is. To answer the question that might be on your mind immediately, I'm from Minnesota. I support all of the Minnesota teams. And so
you will die a Vikings fan.
I will die of Vikings, Twins, Timberwolves, Wild, whatever, Lynx, all of that. I will die a Minnesota sports fan. I'm settling in for, if you know anything about the Vikings, they break our hearts every year. I'm settling in for that. We started out 2-0, so I'm ready for the eventual heartbreak. I'm a huge sports fan, so I love playing sports. I love watching sports. On the flip side, I love board games.
Yeah.
And if you, I don't even, maybe some of you may not know, I love Dungeons & Dragons. I love playing Dungeons & Dragons. If you don't know what that is, you should look it up. If you do know what that is, you probably don't know what it is if you've never done it. So, those feel like they're very different, but I love all that stuff. And I love hanging out with friends and family, barbecues and stuff. I love getting out on the water. I grew up in Minnesota, so yeah. Boating life and lake life is something that I love to do, and things like that. So movies, TV, love hanging out and just kind of watching movies and TV and, adventures, whatever. I feel like I'm kind of up for a lot of pretty much anything.
Right. Yeah.
But, yeah.
Awesome. So, okay, here's the curveball question. I didn't give you this one ahead of time, yeah. So what is one thing that, one thing about yourself that maybe most people don't know? Maybe it's something that you enjoy doing, or just something about your personality that maybe people might be surprised to know.
I would probably, I guess, the first thing that came to mind was kind of a little bit of like, I'm usually up for anything.
Right.
For instance, I had a friend of mine, a buddy of mine, he was going to get married. And so we did a bachelor party in San Diego, California. This was on Southern California. And they planned to go skydiving. They didn't tell me. And they,
oh, by the way,
they also, I mean, the reality is they also know I'm like afraid of heights.
Oh, nice.
And so they're like, we're at the bachelor party, and they're like, all right, we're going to go do something. And we're like, all right, great. So we all get in the car, and we're driving.
So does, like, everybody know this but
everybody
you?
Knows this but me.
Yeah, okay, I got you. All right.
And so we're driving to go to the skydive place, and so we're just kind of hanging out and talking. And every now and then I see somebody, like, look at me, like, with, like, a weird look, and I'm like, what is going on? And all of a sudden we pull into, like, this airport. Like, you know, one of those municipal kind of where they do the skydiving stuff. And I'm like, what? Why are we at the airport? And we pull up to this hangar, and it just says skydiving above it. And everybody just kind of looks at me, and I was like, all right, let's go. And so I got an airplane, and I jumped out of an airplane. Yeah. So even though I have things where I'm like, I'm not sure about that, like I'm usually up for anything and willing to overcome fears and go for it. So
that's awesome. That's awesome.
And if you've never been skydiving, it's amazing. It is.
Would you do it again?
I probably would. but it you'll never experience anything that will feel like skydiving.
All right.
Like it feels different than anything else you'll ever do. Like the experience of it, the feeling of it. If you've never done it, I encourage you to take the leap.
Nice.
Even if you're like, I could never do it. Just
do it.
Just do it. It's a unique, amazing feeling. Anyways, sorry.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
I'm like looking out. I've seen people that are like,
ain't going to happen.
Not a chance.
All right. Well, hey, will you thank Derek this morning for being here? Don Rice is going to come, and Don is going to pray for us and pray for this process. So the intent this morning is that you would get to know Derek a little bit, and then in a couple weeks, our process is there's a church vote. We'll kind of see where things go from here, but then if we decide to move forward and we didn't scare Derek off, then in a couple weeks we'll take a church vote. And so a lot of this is just to give you an opportunity so you can vote with a little bit of knowledge and all that. So Don, will you pray for us?
Please join me in prayer. And dear Lord, we just would hold up Derek and the whole selection process to you, and we just seek to honor you and make the right decisions, and we just would like to have your blessing on the process here and your guidance. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Thanks, Derek. Thank you. All right, everybody, one more time, tell Derek thank you. All right. If you guys wouldn't mind grabbing that, that'd be awesome. Yeah, that'd be helpful. Everybody knows how I am without my notes, so here we go. All right. Well, hey, we've got a full morning this morning, and we've had an awful lot going on. And again, if it's your first time with us this morning, we're not normally quite this chaotic, but it is what it is this morning. So let's pray one more time. Father, thank you for this day and for your faithfulness and goodness. God, thank you that you have revealed yourself to us that we might know you and walk with you. God, thank you for giving us your word that teaches us about who you are, that gives us the truth about the gospel message. And God, thank you for being at work in our hearts and changing us through your word. And God, we just pray that that would happen this morning. And we pray all of that in your son Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen, amen. All right. Well, we're short on time this morning. So just going to warn you, we're just going to kind of blaze through this a little bit this morning. It'll be a little bit like drinking out of a fire hydrant. But we've been in this series, all right? This is, I don't know what week, but we're in chapter 3 of the book of Romans. The title of our series is The Gospel Unveiled. And so this morning we're going to look at verses 1 through 20. And the topic is the universality of sin. So let me ask you, parents, how many of you remember the moment that your first child was born? Right? You don't have to raise your hands. No, raise your hands. It's okay. How many of you remember that moment? Like for me, when Madison was born, it was a very, very vivid memory. I remember her being born. I remember I got to cut the cord. I remember counting all of her fingers and toes to make sure they were all there. And then, and maybe you can relate to this, there was this thought that occurred to me, she's so small. She looks so small and so utterly helpless. And this thought came over me like, oh, man, this child is going to rely on me for everything, for a large portion of her life. Like, I'm responsible because she can't do anything for herself at this point. How many of you remember, okay, you can raise your hand. How many of you remember that point, right, where your child was born and maybe you had that sort of feeling? Well, Paul is here in Romans chapter 3. Paul is setting up his Jewish readers to understand, right, that true righteousness comes from him and him alone. His point will be that righteousness, it doesn't come from us, but like newborn babies, right? We are helpless. We are utterly helpless to produce righteousness or the kind of righteousness needed to pay the price for our sins. A couple of weeks ago, as we were kind of getting started in this part of the book of Romans, and again, if it's your first time and you're kind of jumping in with us this week, there's a lot of background, a lot of context that you probably haven't gotten. So I'm going to do my best to kind of fill in just a little bit. But a couple weeks ago, I gave you this illustration to help you understand what Paul is doing in these first few chapters of Romans. All right? It's like when you go to the jeweler and ask to see a beautiful piece of jewelry, the jeweler lays out a piece of black fabric, right, to show off the spectacular beauty of that piece of jewelry. And that is what Paul is doing here. Paul is laying out this black velvet fabric background to show off the beauty of the gospel message. So these first couple chapters are the black fabric, okay, because he wants to then show off the message of the gospel against this background. Remember, the word gospel means good news. So Paul is making a case for the good news about what Jesus has done and why that is important and why that message should be the message that the church rallies around. Because the church in Rome was so divided over these kind of peripheral issues. The Jews thought that the Gentile Christians, the Jewish Christians thought the Gentile Christians, well, they should follow these laws and these dietary laws and follow the Sabbath and they should be circumcised and all these things. And it was causing all of this division. But Paul wants to rally them around the most important thing, and that is the message of the gospel. And last week we saw that Paul talked about how God is more concerned with what is going on inside of your heart than what everyone sees you doing on the outside. And we said that outward expression means nothing if not accompanied by inward experience. Right? That outward expression, it's pointless, it doesn't mean anything if it's not, right, if it's not accompanied by inward experience. So as we look at the beginning of chapter 3, Paul is addressing, he's anticipating some of the questions that are going to come up from these Jewish Christians, all right? Because he knows he's going to get some pushback, and so he begins addressing their questions. And it starts here in verse 1 of chapter 3. Paul says, so what advantage does the Jew have? Or what is the benefit of circumcision? Right? Basically, he's anticipating these questions. Look, is there any value then to being a Jew? Is there any advantage to being a part of the covenant that God made with the Jews. Look at verse 2. He says, first, they were entrusted with the very words of God. What then? If some were unfaithful, will their unfaithfulness nullify God's faithfulness? Absolutely not. Let God be true, even though everyone is a liar, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and triumph when you judge. Okay, so these couple of verses, a little bit hard to wrap your brain around. So Paul is anticipating the question. Well, you know, if there's no value in all of these external things that we do, like getting circumcised and following the law, if God is really concerned about the heart, what's the point in doing them? What's the point in even being a Jew? And Paul says, well, there is value. Okay, Paul says, even though you don't understand the reason that the law was given to you, that it was to show your sin, right? The law was like a mirror. It showed off the sin of the Jews, the sin of the whole world. They didn't understand that they needed a Savior, and that was the purpose of the law, and you missed that, he said. But even though you don't understand, the fact remains that because you had the law to guide you, you've been uniquely blessed. In other words, even though throughout history the Jews missed the reason, they missed the point, they missed the why behind the giving of the law, they still experienced the results, right, or the blessings of keeping the law, right? And there are these benefits and blessings that come from keeping the law. Even though they didn't understand the why, they still benefited from keeping it. For example, when the bubonic plague swept across Europe, it killed one of every three people. But did you know this? That the Jewish population was almost untouched by the bubonic plague. Because the dietary laws, all right, within the law about hygiene and diet and all of those kinds of things really circumvented it. It allowed them to miss the bubonic plague. The Jews were protected from the plague because of that. Also throughout history, all right, historically, the Jews have done well financially. All right, why? Because the financial principles continued within the law. They just work. All right, they're true, regardless of whether or not you know God or you follow God or you're close to God. If you follow those rules, they're still right. They're still truth. Even though you may have been unfaithful in keeping the law, Paul says, God will always be faithful. Your unfaithfulness does not nullify God's unfaithfulness. So, again, Paul anticipates these questions. This question comes up, right? If that's true, if God is going to continue to be faithful even though I'm unfaithful, why not continue to be unfaithful, especially if my unfaithfulness shows off God's faithfulness? What is the point of being faithful? In other words, if God's covenant is going to be there regardless of how I act, then what's the point of even following the law? What's the point of doing good works? What's the point of doing any of this? And Paul, and I'm just going to kind of, for time's sake, going to say it this way. Paul basically says, look, don't be stupid. All right? Don't be dumb. All right? Do that, and we'll kind of see where that gets you. Whoever thinks like that deserves what they get, all right? There's still these natural consequences. There's still a natural consequence of disobedience to the law. And then look what Paul says here in verse 9. He says, what then? Are we any better off? Not at all, for we have already charged that both Jews and Greeks are all under sin. I said, well, are we Jews in any better position for following the law and being circumcised? Have we gotten any bonus points? I mean, are we actually any better off? And Paul says, no, because the fact remains that we are all under sin. It's not just that we have all sinned. So in chapters 1 and 2, Paul really drives home the point, right, that we have all sinned. And there's no excuse for any of us. And when we judge other people because of their sin, we're judging ourselves because we do the same things that we're accusing other people of doing. Because God, remember, is more concerned with what goes on inside of our hearts than he is what is going on the outside. Are we any better off, they ask. Paul says, no, we are all under sin. It's not just that we have all sinned, all right, but we are all under sin. We carry the burden of sin. And sin is a burden, isn't it? Sin is a burden. It wrecks us. It's a heavy burden that we carry when we lose the joy and the peace of life because of our sin. We're all under the dominion and the influence of sin. That's kind of the idea there. It's not just that we have all sinned, but we're under sin. We're under the burden. We carry the heavy burden of sin. And then Paul goes on to quote several passages from the Old Testament showing us what it means to be under sin. And so he draws from the Psalms and several other places and kind of encapsulates, like, this is what it means to be under sin. And then in verse 19, he says this, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are subject to the law, so that every mouth may be shut and the whole world may become subject to God's judgment." The problem of sin, Paul says, is universal. The entire world is under sin, he says. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus made it clear that keeping the law, and we've kind of been jumping back and forth between Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and the things that Paul is saying, because Jesus basically said the same things that Paul is kind of underscoring those teachings from the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus made it clear that keeping the law was not about external regulations, but more about internal attitudes. Because of that, we're all murderers, right? Jesus said, if you're angry with your brother or your sister, you have committed murder in your heart. By that standard, none of us measure it. We're all under sin. Jesus said that that committing adultery is wrong, but if you simply look with lust on another woman, you've committed adultery with her in your heart. Right? Jesus, he didn't just like raise the bar. He was saying, look, you can't meet this bar in your own strength, in your own ability. We're all adulterers, even though we might not exhibit those behaviors externally. They take place in our hearts inwardly. And then verse 20, he says this, "For no one," and this is the crux right here, I love this verse, "For no one will be justified in his sight by the works of the law, because the knowledge of sin comes through the law." After laying out the black background, right? After laying out the black background and showing us the universality of the problem of sin, Paul now begins to introduce this beautiful concept, this beautiful idea of justification. And as he talks about justification, it's going to sparkle against this dark background. Justification, again, let me read this verse, 3:20 again, "For no one will be justified in his sight by the works of the law, because the knowledge of sin comes through the law." Justification, right, is a legal term that carries with it the idea of being much more than forgiveness or a pardon. Sometimes when we talk about being justified, all right, we think about that as being pardoned or simply being forgiven. But justification means being declared righteous, as though we never sinned at all. Right? You cannot, the works of the law, what you do, will never justify you, Paul says. Okay? We're all under sin. This is a problem that is universal. Okay? But if you try and rectify that problem by good works, it will never happen. Justification does not come by the law. Justification is a beautiful and wonderful concept and doctrine in the Bible. Let me illustrate it this way. In English, I read this story about an English gentleman who he bought a Rolls Royce in England and had it shipped across the channel so he could drive through France. And so as he's driving through France, kind of, and if you've ever been to Europe, you know there's just lots of small little communities and small little roads and lots of places to explore. And so he drove his Rolls Royce through the countryside of France, but while he's on his trip, the Rolls breaks down. And so he calls the dealer in London. He said, "Hey, the car that I just bought from you, it is broken. Can you come fix it?" And they said, we'll be there shortly. And within an hour, a team of mechanics on the plane, they went to the guy where his Rolls was. They dismantled it. They fixed it. And he was back on the road again. When his trip was done, the Englishman returned home, and he waited for what he thought would be what most of us would think would be a large repair bill. You know, they flew a whole team of mechanics to him in France. They came, they fixed the car. He thought, oh, this is going to cost me. But, you know, it was important to him. So he thought, that's okay. But the bill never came. And so he finally called the Rolls dealership and said, "I've been back for several months, but I haven't received a bill for your services." The voice on the other end said, "A bill for what?" "A bill for the repairs you did in France on my Rolls." "Sir," insisted the dealer, "we have no record whatsoever of any repairs being done on any Rolls Royce at any time. Thank you." That's justification. That is a picture of justification, just as if it never broke. Look, God doesn't say this is not God's attitude. God doesn't say, "Well, I've just been bearing with you, putting up with your sin. But I'm such a good God that, well, I'll overlook it. I love you so much. I'm just going to turn a blind eye to your sin." No. See, once I have faith in Jesus, God sees me as being justified, as though I never sinned. That's what justification is. Like a newborn infant, I am powerless to justify myself, but our Father in heaven, who loves us with an everlasting love, He made a way. Later, Paul will write this in Romans chapter 8, familiar verse, I think, to many of you. Can we read this out loud together this morning? Are you ready? I love this verse. You should memorize this verse. If you don't have this verse memorized, you should think about memorizing this verse, because this will serve you well if you memorize it. Let's read this out loud together. Ready? "Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus, because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death." This idea of justification has a lot of implications for those of us who follow Jesus. And we're going to start to get into this idea of justification starting next week. But Paul says here in verse 20 that no one will be justified by the works of the law, right? It is only by faith in Jesus, faith in what God has done for you by sending his Son, who died on the cross for your sin but rose 3 days later from the dead, defeating sin and defeating death. That is the only way to be justified. And when we do that, the Bible says, it's like it never happened. It's like your sin never existed. Why is this important? All right? Why is this so critical for you to understand, for me to understand about our walk with Jesus? Right? Because there will be times, probably this week, and I love Sarah's testimony. If you were here last week and Sarah got baptized, she said she just struggled with feeling like she was never good enough, all right? And the enemy will do that to you. The enemy will remind you of your sin, remind you of your past, remind you of those times when you have failed. And you will think in your mind, yeah, I am not worthy. I don't deserve God's love. Obviously, these bad things that are going on in my life, these hardships, they're because I did something bad at some point in my life, right? And our brain starts to go there, and the enemy starts to try and accuse us of our sin. But I want you to know this morning that if you know Jesus, if you placed your faith in him, you have been justified, Paul says. Right? There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I love what Martin Luther said. He said, every week I preach justification by faith to my people because every week they forget it. So as you go out this week and the enemy wants to accuse you of not being good enough or not doing enough or not being enough, all right, I want you to remember that you have been justified, that when God looks at you, it's not sin that he sees. It's not your failure. It's not your shortcomings. It's the blood of Jesus shed on the cross for you that he sees, and he sees the righteousness of Christ, and he loves you with an everlasting love because of that, not because of what you do. Amen? Amen. Father, this morning we say thank you for your word. God, thank you for the words of Paul. God, how you spoke through him to just declare the truth about your goodness and your faithfulness and about our justification. Father, may we go this week and may we remember that as we go and as we have this tendency to forget what you have done for us and what that means. So God, remind us, I pray, in your son Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, thanks for being here this morning. We'll keep you posted about Derek. I know he's going to be available. If you'd like to meet him and connect with him, please do that. I would love to pray with you this morning. If you've got something going on in your life, I would love to connect with you and just pray with you. So hope you have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.